So then let's go over then that stuff quickly. So yeah, I began from here with the file system. So the file system component of the operating system is going to be discussed. So we already talked about this, where file is not a physical thing, it's an abstract entity. It helps us talk, if it makes the process interact with the disk directly. So you cannot write anything to the disk without the file concept around. For example, fprintf, the C, in the C language, will make you write stuff to disk, and there is no other way to write things to disk or any other physical media like CD or USB. Yeah, so this is the picture that I will focus on throughout the topic today. We have a set of processes, and eventually we have this hard disk, and they want to write something to it and read something from it. And to make that possible, operating system, the kernel code, it provides the related codes, the related software. One is this interface, file system interface, which is basically providing functions to the processes. And through that functions, operating system then now runs the file system component part, which talks with the disk driver, and then disk driver knows how to write stuff to disk or read it from disk. So there is this low-level code between disk driver and hard disk, which is not our topic. So we assume that disk driver knows how to talk with the hard disk based on the manufacturer specifications. So the focus of our study today will be on these two boxes, the interface and the actual component. And so the main part of these two is this file system component itself. So let's forget about the interface for a second. This is a software that we use the hardware as a sequence of blocks of some size. Okay. So from the point of view of the file system component, we have these blocks, which are analogous to the pages in our virtual memory chapter. Yeah, so these are the blocks. Those blocks are mapped to the sectors of the disk. So by the disk driver, so the sectors are on the disk, and blocks are abstract entities in the software level. Given a block number, disk driver finds the corresponding sector number. So this mapping is assumed to be given by this driver to hard disk channel. So the operating system leaves the underneath storage as a sequence of blocks, okay, the file system component. So it doesn't know about the sectors, sector IDs. It just knows about these blocks here. And once it writes stuff here, the disk driver will put the content to the correct sector. And similarly, once I read something from the block, the disk driver will bring it from the corresponding sector to the block, and from the block, now I have access to that content. Applications are viewing the storage as a set of files, so these boxes here. The process, actually, the process doesn't think about the file system component or interface. It just sees these file entities, okay? And it sees them through the interface. But at the highest level, process sees a file only, which is not a physical thing. Again, this is just an abstraction, abstract entity. the corresponding physical content is going to be on the disk. So we have to establish a mapping between the files that processes talk with and the blocks that component knows, and then the driver has the mapping from the blocks to the sectors. So a file is sitting in some of these blocks, either continuously or separately, like part of it here, part of it here. So no neighborhood information, it doesn't matter. A file is going to sit on some of these blocks. If a file content needs to occupy four blocks, for instance, then the OS file system component decides these four blocks, the four blocks to be used. Okay, so now the outline of the class today is as follows. I will first talk about this little box, the interface, where I mentioned the functions provided to the processes. And then in the next session, we will talk about the component itself, which will deal with the file to block mapping. Okay, so in other words, the component will implement the services provided by the interface. So these are very related things, actually. So that's why the first part is not going to be too algorithmic. We will just talk about the interfaces, and then we will see some algorithms to implement those interface functions. Okay, so to talk about the interface, let's start from the very beginning, where we have a file, okay, which is just, it has its own logical address space, right? You can go through this file consecutively. So it has its own logical address space. But the corresponding components are in the blocks, in the kernel code, kernel area, kernel memory. But they are not necessarily contiguous. Operating system makes the arrangement so that you view the file as a contiguous logical address space. So you mean link the process. What can we store in a file? A very basic question. Obviously, data can be stored, either numeric or textual or even binary data that is not directly human readable. And we also sometimes store program, the code itself, which will make your program. So what about the file structure? Actually, there is no specific structure at all in the popular operating systems like Unix and Windows. We just have a sequence of bytes around that make up a file. You can implement a record structure where now you have a sequence of records that come with a specific format, like either fixed length or variable length. So this is a record structure. Another record structure, still, we can call it a complex structure. So these are understood by specific programs only, like the .doc extension, which is a Word program. So operating system doesn't know how to process it. So what it does is it creates, forks the corresponding program, which is MS Word, and then let that program's instructions deal with that file. Okay, so the formatted files are not directly accessible by the OS. It uses a different process to handle that file. But sometimes the file is just the executable file, like the one you end up with after compiling your C code. You said gcc main.c. dash out O, A, for instance, then A will be your executable, and operating system knows how to deal with it. Okay, it is just a sequence of bytes where the instructions are hidden, so operating system can deal with it directly. It doesn't need to fork another process to handle it. But after all, everything can be seen as a sequence of bytes. So with a file, as you know, there are some attributes. Name is the only information that is human readable. You can make some idea about that file using the name. The others are for operating system usage only, like identifier. It's a unique number, unique tag that identifies the file within the file system. So using that, you will put the entries to your directory structures. So it's going to be a unique ID with a file, because as you know, name is not unique. Type of the file, so is it an executable, it's an object file, is it a Word file, so it's a very self-explanatory attribute. Location is also important. It is a pointer to the file location on the device. So it is the access point, like this is the dummy head of your linked list, or the front pointer of your queue, etc. Size, we keep this and maintain this. So we don't want to compute this from scratch, so we maintain this as an attribute, because once I want to get the size of the folder, then I just want to use this entry in constant time. I don't want to recompute the file size over and over again. So you compute it once, and then you maintain it, obviously. When you grow the file, this will be updated, etc. But this is an attribute that is that should come with the file to prevent computations for every request. Like, again, I said the folder size request. Protection is about the privileges. Who can access this file? Who can read it? Who can write it? Who can execute it? And there are some timestamps for security and also for usage monitoring. We have user identification. So these are all attributes coming with a file. Information about files are kept in the directory structure. This is an important structure, and it is maintained on the disk, not in the memory, because it will be a huge thing. So we shouldn't reserve our memory to that. We will have a part of the disk handling all my files. We call it directory structure, the directory. So let's look at this directory then. So I am in the disk here. This big box is a disk. I have the files, which are, again, file is an abstract entity, but the content of it is physically written in this disk. Okay. And with every file, we have these attributes, the metadata, which are here, we discussed. And in the directory, which is, again, a place in the disk, we have the identifier of that file, like let's call it name, and then the pointer to the attribute of this file. And in the attribute list, I have a pointer to the beginning of this file anyway. So implicitly, directory can access this file. In the directory, by the way, you can maintain this as a tree structure, which would be more efficient. But regardless, we have information about files, attributes, and the locations of the files. We have one entry per file, which is the identifier of the file and the pointer to the attributes. So what operations can I do on a file? Or in other words, can I do on the disk through this file abstraction? I can create it, like reserve a location in disk for me, and then I grow it by writing to it or read the contents. And within the file, I can go to the desired location. I can delete the file, or I can trim the file, etc. So these operations will be implemented by the component, file system components, and we will discuss how to implement them in the next class. And the application programmer basically uses these operations to interact with the hard disk. Open file identifier is going to do the following. It will search the directory for the entry FI and move the content of the entry to the memory. Okay, so that disk is now in the memory because I don't want to go back and forward to disk for every read operation. So once you open it, you bring the file either partially or fully. It will be, it is going to be decided by your current paradigm. But yeah, so you will move the content to the memory. And when you close the file with its unique identifier, we move the content of the entry FI in the memory to the directory structure on the disk. And we also update the disk. So again, for efficiency, now I have this memory in my life, okay? So not just the disk. Okay, directory structure is in the disk, as we discussed, no problem with that. However, say a read operation comes for an open file. Then I search the disk, the directory on the disk, which is a slow action because of the disk access, to locate this file to be read, okay, FI. Then I go to that location indicated by the entry, which is here, file FI. And I do the reading. But now I need to do something because for every read request, I don't want to come to directory, find the location, go there, and read the next instruction. It is slow. So what operating system gives you is an open file table, which is in the memory, physical memory. Basically, what happens is only the open system call, only that one goes to disk. So again, system calls are expected to be slower because it talks with the hardware mostly. So open is one of them. It talks with the hardware, the hard disk in this case, and it searches the directory, locates the FI, and then caches it into the open file table, okay, which is basically puts it here, and returns the index of the open file table entry to the process, which is what we call file descriptor, by the way. So if you wonder why you have an integer file descriptor for each of your files, these are actually index of that file in the open file table. Okay, so instead of going through the directory structure in the disk, I will go through this directory structure, but I call it an open file table, which provides me the desired attribute, the pointer to the desired attribute set, which has a pointer to the file. So file is on the disk, okay? But the location of the file, that information is now in memory. Because for every read operation, which are expected to be done a lot, like in a for loop, I will look at this file table in the memory called open file table. And I will look at the entry in the index called file descriptor. And from there, I know the file, and I also resume from where I left for the reading. So subsequent operations, or also for the writing, the same business, we can use the file descriptor handle, which gives access, which is designed for this open file table. So that is an index for the open file table in the RAM. So I go here using that file descriptor. I never go to the disk again unless I do the close operation. Yes. So for the open file table, I keep this file pointer, the pointer to the last read and write location per process that has the file open. So this pointer is different per process because more than one process can be using the file, the same file. So each of them is at a different location of this file. So I have a specific pointer that will point to the last read and write location per process. File open count is a counter that tells me the number of times a file is open. In other words, the number of processes referring to that file. So if this count becomes zero, then I will remove it from the open file table, because after all, open file table is using my precious memory, which is a limited amount of size. So I will get rid of it when the count is zero, which happens when the last process calls the close system call. And the disk location of the file is important. This is the real chunk, the data in the file. I will go there. And access rights are these privileges. Not all the users can do everything with the same file. So let's see this slide with a visual here. Okay, so with a process, there comes this open file we have this open file table per process, and it has the, for instance, current position pointer to that file, which allows that process to go to the disk to do the action to that location. Actually, the open file table is system-wide. It is the same for all processes. So that's why, this is written here, system-wide open file table. Okay. File types are more or less, we are familiar with them, executables that can be understood by the OS directly, because these are ready to run machine language programs. But the textual data, for instance, they are not ready to run. These are treated by the processes. These are parsed by the processes and then made useful. So we have different types. Let's not go through all of them, but I am sure you are familiar with all of them anyway. So for the opening, you can manually start the application that reads the file and load the file in it, like Microsoft Word example. Or if there is some association with that is in the file attribute set, then operating system can fork that application directly, which will then put the file and load it. I can access files sequentially, which is what we do with the fcknf actually. For instance, what it means is you just read the next, so to go to the 20th line, you have to do 19 read actions to go there. But in the direct access, you can directly go to the end line and then read it and write to it, whatever. Yeah, so sequential access is visualized here. This is your current position, and you can just have access to the next location. You can rewind, it will bring you to the beginning. We can share files on multi-user systems, which is a desirable thing. Again, the file open count will help me to understand if there is anyone left sharing this file. We can also put some protection, since sharing is sometimes dangerous for privacy. So these are not our direct topics, but in distributed systems, the sharing happens over a network. So we have multiple computers sharing the file. And NFS, the network file system, is a common file sharing method through distributed systems. Yes, so the user IDs identify users. And we give permissions to IDs. Group ID can cluster many users into one group. So in the file attributes for a file, we have the user ID, the group ID part, and then what I can do is, with these IDs, I can define protection based on these IDs. So what I mean, each file has associated protection bits, okay, read, write, executable, 10, 10, 10 for each of them. And so these are set for specific user and for the group. And in other words, all the users in this group. So how to do that? Is so where am I? Okay, I am talking about this here. For instance, let's take the Unix as our case study. The access modes can be read, write, and execute. So the owner of the file, the 7 is the decimal, but it actually gives 111, which is the binary of 7. So for all the read, write, execute actions, where X for the execute. And for a group, I just give read and write permissions. So I just set 6 for the group part. And for the public, I just allow execution of the file, not the reading of the file, not the writing to the file. So basically, for a particular file, say game.exe, using this change mode command, I have 3 decimals, first of which sets the privileges for the owner, second for the group, and third for the public. So this example 761, actually I write it here. So it's not 761. We have these 761, and they assign the privileges to the owner, group, and public respectively. Yeah, and if you want to add someone else, if you want to attack a group to this file, we just use change group command. But change mode command is very popular, and this is its purpose. This is used to set privileges protection for the file. So using that to the program.c, for instance, we have first tree for the owner, then the group, then the public. So I will stop here actually, because this is the end of the interface part, so everything may not be clear at this point, but no problem, because once we implement these services, you will understand things better. Okay, so let me do that in 10 minutes with a different session. I will talk about how to implement the file system in an operating system, the file system component. So this component requires us to design some algorithms and some data structures, either in memory or on the disk structures. And one of the main goal is to map the logical file system into the physical storage device. Okay, so let's go then. We have, first of all, we have this file control block, similar to the PCB process control block associated with each process, as we have seen in the very beginning of the course. So the storage structure consisting of the information about the file, we call it the FCB, file control block. It is stored in the disk. So the application programs, they see the file as a logical consecutive address space. And we go all the way down to the device. So these representations are useful for the file system component, and then file system component connects to the device driver where the actual writing to the disk happens. So maybe I should show this general idea again. So this is what we do in the file system business. Is the process, it has this we have in the operating system, we have this whole file system component. So these are softwares in the kernel. So these are in kernel code, operating system code. The file system interface gives me the functions, gives the process the functions to communicate with the file system component. And this component talks with the disk driver, which eventually interacts with the hard disk through the manufacturer level assembly code, which is brand specific. So we are not that interested in this communication, but we rather want to understand what is going on in this gray box. The interface part is an overview where we discuss the functions provided to the process. And now in the file system component, let's see what is really going on. So if I come here, a process issues is a file related code, okay, instruction, which is like open. Then what happens in the background is in the we search the directory, find the location, file location, and determine which file blocks will be used. And then these blocks, the logical blocks, okay, they are mapped to the disk blocks, which are the physical blocks. Mm-hmm. And then we have this in the last layer, we perform buffering of the disk data and write it to disk or read it from disk by updating the cache. So this slide is even more explanatory. So we have this file system. Okay, so user's process or processes view of file is just a sequence of logical address. Okay, we have indices going in order, so we have this set of contiguous blocks called the file. But the file system actually uses actually sees this file, this big rectangle, as a set of smaller rectangles, which are called the blocks, disk blocks. And then comes the disk driver, which knows the disk geometry, the manufacturer specific information, and it maps the blocks, disk blocks, to the corresponding sectors. Okay, so these are all different sized visualizations here to show you the difference. I have this file, which is the user's point of view. I have the blocks, disk blocks, which is the file system component point of view. And I have the disk driver, which maps these blocks into the sectors. Okay. So block the sector mapping. Let's just talk about it for a second, then we will leave this sector stuff. So this driver will know the disk geometry as discussed and map the disk blocks to disk sectors with a quite simple mapping. So in this example, the first two blocks go to the first two sectors. Okay, then actually this is rather different. So the first block occupies two sectors here, 0 and 1, and the second block occupies another two sectors, 2 and 3. Yeah. And by sectors, I mean physical locations on the cylinders, on the tracks that are put on top of each other in the shape of a cylinder. Okay. Well, this guy is... So how do I map files to disk blocks? Okay, so let's go over an example. I have the sector size of 512 bytes. Okay, and the block size can be like 4 kilobytes, okay, 4096 bytes. So in Unix, it is indeed 4 kilobytes. So block size is a multiple of sector size. In this case, it is 8 times bigger. So given a file, the red file, I will so this file will occupy 2 blocks, and the blue file is bigger, it will occupy 3 blocks. And the mapping is as follows: these two goes to indices 2 and 3, and the other is not contiguous, as you can see, so there is no rule about that. And eventually, if you look one step further, the red here goes to four in total of 4 different sectors. Yeah, so to implement the file system software maintains major on-disk structures. So on the disk, what do I have? I have boot control block, which is the information needed by the system to boot the operating system. So this is written on the disk. And it is triggered in the power on time. It is the first block of disk accessed, and inside of which we have a small program which loads the kernel in. I have volume control block where I have information about the volume, how many blocks I have, where is the directory location, etc. And the directory structure where I have pointers to the files on the disk. So this is a very important structure. And also we have this per file file control block in which we can find attributes of the file. So file system gets commands from the processes and issues to driver. Yes, as expected. And driver knows how to talk with the disk. So let's focus on the directory structure, which is very important. When you want to open a file or do another action like reading, you search the directory for a given file name, and then you find the corresponding information of the file. So since directory is on the disk, I need a fast algorithm to do this search, because access to disk is costly. I should reduce it as much as possible. A linear list of file names is the simplest idea. It is not a special algorithm. It is not even a binary search. It is just a linear search. It is simple to program, but it is time consuming to execute, because to find a given file name, I have to look at all the previous files, and I don't know the amount of them. Hash table is a better alternative, where we have the linear lists with hash structure. So then your file name brings you to a specific location in this hash table, but that will not directly give you the answer, probably, because there are collisions, like multiple file names are mapping to the same location. And in case of a collision, we can do some linear probing or separate chaining, that business, you know, from data structures to get the content from the directory on the disk. Now comes the important question: how can we allocate disk space to files? So this is probably the most important issue with respect to the file systems. Because as we established, a disk is seen as a sequence of blocks. So I will distribute my file into these blocks. Okay, I will segment my file and put part of it into different blocks. How disk blocks are allocated for files? This is the question I will discuss now. There are three alternatives. Contiguous allocation. So this is the file data. I just put this as a whole, as a continuous entity or contiguous entity. So this is something we know from the virtual memory concept, right? So you will see similarities now. Each file occupies a set of contiguous blocks on disk, okay? It is simple, because what you need to store is only the starting block, which is 6 in this example, and then the number of blocks you need, which is 4 in this example. And since you have this continuous layout, random access is quite fast. You can just go to the 58th line of this file by just going to the correct disk in one shot and then going offset amount within that block. But there is a big problem. We waste space. So dynamic storage, so we can't, so since I need a set of consecutive blocks, even if I have that space, but if that space is distributed through the disk, then I can't get it. So you can do something called fragmentation to shuffle the empty blocks and the free blocks and the occupied blocks to bring all the free blocks all together. So these are all extra operations that are costly. Also, another problem with the contiguous allocation is about the file growth. So assume that I have allocated four blocks here. I want to write something more to this file. So it demands growth. So it can only grow if the immediately next block is available. So, but maybe there is some other file occupying this block and there is an emptiness in block two. I can't just grow to two from nine. So I can't do the growth using the contiguous tactic. So these are the disadvantages. But now let's do some random access, for instance. Given an offset, which is byte x of the file, or the logical address is the x you may want to go. The initial point is zero, so x is somewhere in the middle. What is the corresponding dislocation, the physical location given x? Obviously, I need to know the starting block, which is 6. And I also need to know the block size, which is, in this example, 1 kilobyte. So which disk block contains the byte 0 of this file? And then I also need to answer what is the displacement on that block. So disk block 6 and displacement 0 will bring me to the beginning of the file. Which disk block contains the byte at logical address 2500? So to compute that, I first get rid of the first two blocks by dividing this to the block size, so 2 is skipped, and then I am in the correct block, but I need the offset, which is obtained by taking the mod, by taking the remainder of the division of 2500 with 1024. So the offset will be 452. So what you need to do is you need to come to the block 28, because 6 is the start and 2 is what I found just above, and within the block 8 I need to go 452 steps. Okay, so in the directory structure, what you see is the file identifier, let's say simply the file name, and the starting block for that file, which is 0, and the length of it, which is 2. So for a different file like mail, I need, so this is the mail file starting at 19, I need 6 blocks, 19 and 6, etc. Extent-based system is similar. It addresses the growth problem of the contiguous allocation, though. So what you have is, you initially make a guess, like size of my file will be X, okay? Then you allocate that space to your file. Even if currently the file size is less than X, you allocated X. So you guarantee that you can grow it, because the next byte will be available up to the X choice. When file tries to grow more than the extent, then you allocate another extent and you point to that extent. So the new extent doesn't have to be contiguous. Yeah, so in that case, a file consists of more extents if the initial extent doesn't cut it for you. But the idea is that in the extent-based allocation, linked allocation is a totally different approach. It is in the spirit of a linked list. So with so this is your disk block. The data part of it is the bigger part, obviously. The file data is here. And I also reserve a small part that is for the pointer that points to the next next block for the same file x. Okay, so this similar approach goes like this. You have file x, it starts at block 5. Now you can write some data into block 5, and when you fill it up and you still have more to write, then you find another empty block, say 3, and you put 3 to the next part of this block. Then you go and write it to 3. It again doesn't finish. Then you go to the block 8, where you write even more, and then you go to block 10, where you write even more. Then the director structure will look like this. You don't have to keep the end block actually, just the start is enough. So for this file, start from 9, it will bring you to it will bring you to the next block, and this will also move you to the next block, etc. So this is a simple method as well. You just need to start. You just need to store the starting address, so this part, again, not the end, is required. Information to be maintained in the directory entry is just, in this example, 5 for this example. And in contiguous allocation, recall that you also store an additional information, which is the number of blocks. In this case, in the linked allocation, you don't have to do that. There is no external fragmentation problem. You don't have to spend time on it. There is no waste of space because everything grows dynamically. But the bottleneck is random access is a problem here. Yes, so the in our random access. So, teşekkürler. Evet. So you can't just go to index 10. You have to follow the next pointers. So in the linked allocation, this is an example here. Given offset x, which is the byte x of the file, where to go? What is the logical to physical mapping? So first, I get rid of the pointer part from the whole block, which gives me the data size. Then the block number will be x over data size, where x is the input location I want to go. So this will move me to the correct block, and then after that I need to go offset amount, which is the remainder of this division. So in a particular example where x is 2900, we go to block 2, and in that I travel this much bytes. So because going to the second block is not just enough, I also need to skip the pointer part. That's why the computation of offset is a little bit different here. I want to talk about the FAT file allocation table, a term you are familiar with probably, FAT32 for 32-bit systems, for instance. So this addresses the problem of storing this little pointer part with each disk block. I don't want to spend storage for that. I rather want to keep this file allocation table. I will collect all these pointers in one table. So then what is the number of entries in the table? It will be the number of blocks on the disk, because one entry will move you to one block. Okay. So this is a system used in MS-DOS in the 90s. So this goes like this. In your FAT, the file allocation table, we have the file identifier, let's say it's the name, and the start block, which is 217, and in this table, I know where to go. So after the first block is done, I need to go to the second block of this file, which is in this index, 600 stuff, and the third block will be in the index 339. So then the simple question for this example is how many blocks allocated to this file. By looking at the non-zero entries in this FAT for this file, I see that three blocks are allocated for this file called name, called test. You can load FAT into memory if it is not that big. Then you can even do these random accesses very quickly. Yeah, so now the other scheme is about index allocation. So you will see similarity is with the linked allocation, but index allocation is different in that you have a specific block that is holding your indices. Okay, so what do I mean by this? Brings all pointers together into the index block. So in this scenario, index of blocks allocated to the file are here, and from these blocks, these indices, you can go to the correct blocks. For sequential reading of the file from beginning to the end, you just access to the index table and just go through the entries within that block. Okay, so only one access will be necessary. The index table size will designate the number of blocks in the file, because every entry in this table is actually a block for your file. So for this file, for instance, called keep, in the directory structure, I just keep a pointer to the index block. So I reserve one disk block for the indices of this file only. So I go to the index block, which is sitting at block 19. And within this, I know where to go. So the first block of this file is at 9 here. Second block is here in 16, third is 1, fourth is at 10, and the last block is in index 25. So this file occupies only 5 blocks, and I can just sequentially read this file from the beginning to the end by just going through the lines in this index block. So I don't have to jump from one disk block to the other and read the next pointer of it. So this is a different strategy. Random access is also fast here, because once you are in this block, you can just go to the fourth entry to go to the block 4, for instance. No waste of space again, because no contiguous allocation. Stuff are scattered throughout your disk already, so you don't need any fragmentation. Yes, and mapping is similar. Just get rid of the first blocks that do not contain your current query address, and now you are in your current query, current block. So you just find your offset using this remainder. So here is a nice question. So what am I talking here about here? Block size is 512 bytes, okay? So every byte, like 32 bits, each byte is 8 bit. So we can store an integer. So every byte will store one integer one index, okay? So what can be the maximum size of a file mapped by the index table approach? So in your operating system, if block size is 512 bytes and you are using index table approach, what is the maximum file size you can support? It is just 256 kilobytes, so very disappointing, but still you can obviously increase the block size. But let's understand the reason here. Index table is going to sit in one block, right, by definition, and in that block you have at most 512 entries. Each entry will allow you to go to that block. So in other words, this implies that you have 512 bytes, 12 blocks that you can go from your index table. Again, each block has the capacity of storing 512 bytes, and I have 512 of them. So you have to multiply these two numbers, which will give you this many of bytes. Divide by 1024, you end up with 256 kilobytes. So I need to do something about it, right? So it doesn't really store big files, so you can't even store a very small test program with this strategy. So you can use a hierarchy of index tables. So this looks like the hierarchical page tables in our virtual memory business. For larger files, we need other index blocks. So you have this outer index block, which brings you to another index table, another index block, and in which now you can go to your disk blocks. So instead of pointing to a disk block, outer table, outer index table points to another index table, which in turn points to many blocks. So let's see this, and actually this brings us to a very important structure called inode, and you should understand this because it gives a nice idea about the file systems, and it can also be useful for your exam. In an inode, this is a block in Unix system. It comes with every file, okay? With every file, we have a corresponding inode, this whole rectangle here, inside of which I have some timestamps, some owners, information mode, etc. But the more important part here is these pointers. So within an inode, I store some of the physical blocks directly. Okay, so this is a, therefore this is a big structure, because some of it has the actual content of the file directly. So there is, I just put the data inside of the inode. So this is a small portion. Yeah, so the small. Okay, so this portion, small portion of the index table is in the inode. Okay, it is this part where I basically go to, using those indices, I can go to the data. So actually, I was partially wrong when I said that the data is inside the inode. It is not true. I have the direct pointers to the data, which is basically some part of your index table, right? It is in your inode. But more interestingly, inode keeps a pointer to another index table, which brings you to the other data of this file, other parts of the data of this file. And it also has a pointer to an index table which points to other index tables. Then I call it a double indirect pointer. Yeah, so, and similarly, I have triple indirect pointer. So now what you need to understand is, given the inode structure with single indirect pointers, double indirects, and triple indirect parts, you can derive the maximum file size you can support with this notion, okay? So I will give you the block size and the size of the direct block part, so that part will obviously be supported, but then you also have to consider the other parts where you have double pointers, the double indirect, you have an index table that points to other index tables, etc. And finally, how to keep track of the free blocks in the disk, because after all, we need to allocate them to the files. There are methods like bit vector method. What is it? So in this bit vector method, which is used in Unix, we have one block allocated for that. Inside that block, I have a set of bits or bitmap. It is going to be, each bit has an information about the availability of one block. So in this case, I have 12 blocks, right? So in the bitmap, 0 means not available, gray, and 1 means available. So 0, the first block is not available because the bitmap is here itself. Don't touch it. And in the current configuration, 1, 2, 3, which are these 3 bits, are 0, meaning that not available. But 4, 5, okay. 3, 6, not. 7, okay. 8, not. 9, 10, okay. Which are these 2 ones. And 11, not okay. Okay. So this is the idea. And let's see a more realistic bitmap where we have more disk blocks, hence more bits here. So according to this configuration, I have I don't have availabilities in the first places, and I have something here. So what is it? It is going to be the 56. So you know that we have 16 bits per row. So you skip the first 3 of them, and then you go 8 here, which points you to block 56. So it is, the advantage here is it is easy to get contiguous files because you are basically looking for a sequence of zeros. Okay, so you can just give them as a whole to a file continuously. But the problem, the disadvantage is we need an extra space for the bitmap. So let's discuss this. Assume that your block size is 2 to the power of 12 and your whole disk size is 1 gigabyte, which is 2 to the power of 30 bytes. So with that logic, how many blocks will I have? Divide this by this. So I have 2 to the 12 blocks. What does it mean? Since I have this many blocks, I need this many bits to be stored. So what is the size of this many bits? I convert it to bytes by divide by 8 and convert it to kilobyte by divide by 1024. So I need 32 kilobyte space just to store the bitmap. Yeah, so this doesn't look like a big deal, but remember, you have only 1 gigabyte of whole disk size, then this 32 kilobyte is still somehow insignificant. We can also use the linked list method to track the free space. How can you do that? Each free block has a pointer to the next free block. So in this case, 4, the next free is 7. So this is the second free block. And then the third free block will be 5, and so on and so forth. You have to begin this process at some point, which is called the first free block, and we keep a pointer to the first free block. And this pointer is maintained in the disk, because file is in the disk. No waste of space, which is a good news, because you don't have to give something as a set of blocks. And you can get contiguous spaces easily because your free blocks are scattered throughout the whole disk. So in this example, the free space head, the head of your linked list is the 2, then 2 points to 3, 3 to 4, 4 to 5. So they don't have to be, it doesn't have to be in this ascending order. It can be in any order. So 3 can point to 25, which can then go to 12. But in this example, they go in that order. Grouping is the similar idea of the linked list method, but now I have more than one pointers in a given block. So remember, in this version, I just have one pointer. So from 4, I can go to only 7, and so on. In this grouping action, once you go to this block, here I store multiple free blocks, like in this case, 83, 82, 127 and 130. And the last of these group will point to the next block in which I have other free pointers. The last one points you to the next block for the other availabilities. So if you look at these numbers, these are the available free blocks for this example. And the counting, which is the last strategy, is going to bring you to the free block, but I don't maintain this extra information on every block. Rather, I just keep this count integer, the second of the pair of data here. So it tells me that from seven, from this block 3, go to the 7 if you need to, because I also know that after 3 I have two availabilities, which is here in this 2. If 2 is not going to be sufficient for you, or if it is the case, then you know that you will go to 7. And you also know that you will find 3 availabilities. So you don't store anything with 8 or 9, which is a good thing. And you know that 3 more free space is here for you. And from here, if it still doesn't cut it for you, you can jump to 11. And you know that only one block after 11 is available, which is 11 itself. Yeah, so this is also enumerating the free spaces, free disk blocks for you. And this is also finishing the current class for you, because it is the last thing I want to mention about the file systems.